Welcome to World Affairs Today, brought to you by the World Affairs Council, Washington, D.C., a leading forum for global education and international affairs.
Good evening. My name is Stephanie Fassler, and I am the International Affairs Director for the World Affairs Council, Washington, D.C. On behalf of the Council, I welcome you to this Ambassador Series program. Many thanks to our strategic partners at the Ronald Reagan Building and International Trade Center for their wonderful hospitality and for providing us with a beautiful venue to hold our public events. Today's event will focus on the Republic of Rwanda and its distinguished representative in Washington, D.C., Ambassador Mathilde Mukantabana. The Republic of Rwanda is a landlocked republic south of the equator in East Central Africa and is known as the Land of a Thousand Hills. From 1894 to 1918, Rwanda was part of the German East Africa colony until it was put under Belgium control through the League of Nations mandate following World War I. Rwanda was granted independence from Belgium in July 1962. Years of tensions between the countries Hutu and Tutsi ethnic groups boiled over in 1994 with the world sitting back and watching as over 800,000 Tutsi and Hutu sympathizers' lives were lost in the Rwandan genocide. On October 25, 2001, Rwanda adopted a new flag and new national anthem as part of their efforts to promote national unity and reconciliation after the genocide. The flag itself represents national unity, respect for work, heroism, and confidence in the future. You may be interested to know that in Rwanda, a mandatory day of community service is observed on the last Saturday of the month, in which everyone contributes to the cleaning of their neighborhood. Tourism, minerals, coffee, and tea are Rwanda's main sources of foreign exchange. Rwanda's parliament has more female members than any other parliament in the world at 64%. This has helped Rwanda transform attitudes throughout its society. Rwanda also notably banned plastic bags in 2008 in efforts to reduce environmental damage. After the U.S. established relations with Rwanda in 1962, and since then, it has assisted in providing basic health services, expanding opportunities in rural areas, improving the foundational educational system and skills through various programs, such as Feed the Future, Power Africa, and the Global Health Initiative. In 2006, the U.S. and Rwanda signed TIFA, the Trade and Investment Framework Agreement. Under this, both Rwanda and the U.S. strive to promote international trade and strengthen their relations. Rwanda is also a participant in President Obama's Malaria Initiative and the African Growth and Opportunity Act. Outside of government cooperation, there is private and educational initiatives. The Howard G. Buffett Foundation project will spend $500 million to assist Rwanda in modernizing sustainable agriculture. Her Excellency Mathilde Mukantabana was appointed Ambassador of Rwanda to the United States in July 2013. Prior to her appointment, she was a tenured professor of history at Consumnes River College in Sacramento, California, from 1994 to 2013. She currently serves as co-founder and president of Friends of Rwanda Association, which has the purpose of expanding the circle of friends of Rwanda and supporting genocide survivors through various initiatives. Our discussant this evening is Mark Albert, chair of the WAC-DC Board of Directors Nominating Committee. He's a partner at Stinson Leonard Street, LLP, where he is the chair of the Bankruptcy and Creditors' Rights Department of his firm. Prior to joining Stinson Leonard Street, Mr. Albert was a litigation counsel with the Tax Division of the U.S. Department of Justice. He received his BA and JD from the George Washington University and an MLT from Georgetown University. He is very active at George Washington, serving as a member of the Council of Columbian College, chair and board member of the Textile Museum, and an independent board member of the GWU Medical Faculty Associates. He is also an actor and has produced 5 theater productions and will be in the upcoming production of King Lear this spring 2017. Please join me in a warm welcome of Ambassador and Mark Albert.
I see in studying your biography that you and I both study history. I was a student of history. You were certainly a student of history and professor of history. How has your studies helped you in your role as ambassador?
That's a very good question. History, if you really don't know your history, you can't do anything. And especially for us as a country, we need to be able to go back to understand where we are. Even when we talk in terms of, someone was mentioning reconciliation, we are talking about colonization, and we are talking about this and that. Without having a sense of history, you can't really understand why we got to a place where we hated ourselves. You know, because we're not born like people who are killers, when your countrymen can kill a million people. So we need to look at the causes, we need to look at the factors, we need to look at all those things. So being the students of history helped definitely, number one, to be able to look at how far we have been, to draw lessons from the past, and to be able to move forward. So I can't talk about being an ambassador or our leadership to do what they are doing, having a vision, without looking at where they are coming from. So history is very important.
Thank you. That's a very good answer. Mm,
thank you.
Many women in your country, many women in your country serve in government.
Right.
It appears many more than the United States. Impressive. Why is that the case? Now, I understand there's some mandatory requirements for women to be in government branches. Certain percentages of women must be included. Is that the reason alone? Is this a good thing, and why? And finally, in this whole convoluted question, how have more women in government changed government, in your view?
Once again, it's a very good question. Rwanda has the highest percentage, and I have to say it's by intention. You need to have leadership that wants those women to be where they are. Number two, it's also because those women can take on the challenges. At the same time, I also have to talk briefly about the history of our country. We, in the wake of genocide, 70% of the population were women. And they were left to tend for the thousands and thousands of orphans who were left in the country. They tried to heal the wounds of that particular period, even though they had been the ones who had been very much victimized by genocide. As a matter of fact, when we talk about genocide and, you know, millions of people dying, but we don't talk about the casualty of genocide who were raped. Not too long ago, in the International Tribunal, they passed a law saying that rape is also part of the weapons of genocide. And that came out of Rwanda because of those women who had the courage. So they experienced the worst of circumstances, and they were able to get enough resilience to take our country from the dust and to be able to mend the fabric of our society. So on one hand, you find the leadership that is put, because for us, and I think it was the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, who said it in one of the conferences in China, that for her, women's rights is human rights. So we take it very seriously. For us, women's rights is human rights. And for us, every single individual in our, when we empower the people, women come. Women are people. It means that we account for each individual in the country of Rwanda. So that's why initially we had intention. That's why we needed the quota system. In all our laws, we established that 30% of all the people in decision making have to be women. But then eventually they surpassed the quota, because of other opportunities that were presented, like educational opportunities, and so on and so forth. So they are competing on their own merits, and they are doing it. People elect them because they can do a good job. They have proven themselves in all those positions. Yeah.
Good answer.
Thank you.
That's wonderful. Now, this is sort of a softball question. This is just something that interests me. I see that you're an ambassador not only to the United States, but also to Mexico, Brazil, and Argentina. That's a lot of countries. How does one handle all that? I can barely take care of being in one city. Do you need to travel to these other countries? What is your responsibilities?
Sometimes you do, and sometimes you find the local leadership to help you while you are not there. I'm a resident ambassador to United States and a non-resident ambassador to the other countries. It means, and quite frankly, because in Argentina, Mexico, or Brazil, especially one of our jurisdictions like the diaspora, we don't have much Rwanda diaspora, but we go for business, for schooling, for other things. It means I don't need to travel there all the time like United States. This country is pretty big, and as you know, diplomacy is not done in Washington. It's done in the states as well because of businesses, because of linkages. So the travel in the United States is pretty extensive. So, but we take care of the other countries as well. It's pretty common for all the countries to take on many different countries because embassies are pretty costly, and to establish one embassy in each different country is very difficult. And, so we do that.
Thank you. A little harder question. Your presidential election is going to be soon upon us. What do Rwandans look for in their leader?
Let me tell you, we don't have much to go far. You know, let me, maybe I go a little bit before. There was a time really we died, quite frankly. And when I say we died, it's not just for the shock value of what I'm telling you, but 1994, just to give you an example, I lost 70 people of my own family, including my parents. So there was a time when as a nation we felt we had died. There was a tiny, tiny light that was left lit. That's why you are still alive. And why did we die? You know, as I said, 1 million people died at the hands of their countrymen. 3 million people left the country. Most of them involved in the killings. We completely lost trust in any kind of institution. When I say institution, I'm talking about the state. When you don't trust your state, you don't even trust your church. The majority of Rwandans died in churches. That even 22 years later, we still have priests, we have bishops who are being tried for genocide. And these are the people who could have preserved the sanctity of our nation. But what happened was that any institution broke the taboos of what we stood for, including the family. Sometimes the people even in the families had crossed that. So we were desperate. And we were flirting with ideas of revenge, with ideas of many different things. You know, I mean, if you were in a position to do anything, you could have done it. So that light I'm talking about is our leadership. Our leadership. Our president and the people who were part of it. They came, they looked at the situation. They took chaff and grain alike, and they said we needed to create a nation. And what they did was that out of that kind of despair and death, they were able to transform a nation that we are all proud of in Africa. That is making waves, that is growing. So when, and I know this has been a big discussion when they say, oh, some people want to stay in power for the sake of it. Our president, Paul Kagame, who is in power right now, people started to think in terms of 2017, because this is when we are getting the elections. And they were afraid, because in our geopolitical situation, we are not as safe as we believe. Burundi is still not at peace. We are in an area where the people even who did the genocide are still rampant. So the people stood up and said, we are not ready to let this leadership go. And they sent petitions, including from all over the world, because our diaspora is pretty much involved in the country affairs as well. So what they did was to send petitions starting in 2013. And those you can go and see online, they were sending a petition, please, we don't want to change right now if we needed to amend the Constitution. The president wouldn't see it. Then it went through the Parliament, went through the Senate, eventually the Supreme Court. He was not satisfied until he asked for a referendum. The referendum came with a very overwhelming majority of people saying, no, we need at least for this leadership to take us through this period and to take us to a place where we can say now we have enough leadership to take us on the next journey. And that's what we did. So I'm very, very comfortable with where we are because I trust 100% our president is going to run because we still need him. So that's pretty much a short of our, the answer you wanted me to give.
That's a good answer. No, I like that. Thank
but
you.
But I had to go to the context because sometimes the people really, without looking at the context of the situation, it's easy to say, oh, all Africans want to stay in power. This president didn't want to go in power. The people asked him to go to stay in power. And what I'm saying here in the United States, for instance, we had about 11 voting polls station. We had one in Washington, D.C., one in Chicago, one in Atlanta, every single place. And you wanted the people confidentially to write whether they wanted it to continue. 98% said we want at least this leadership to take us to the next level. So it's everywhere, and this is not just because even though we are here, but most Rwandans live in Europe because of our connection to the colonial countries. They live in Canada. They did the same. So I can say if there was any kind of democratic push for our president to stay in power, this will be it. And we're very happy.
Very good answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is more specific. Yeah. How has Rwanda's economy benefit from AGOA? And is AGOA in danger with the new Trump administration?
You know, Rwanda has benefited. We are new on the international markets, but opening the door has been a good thing through the AGOA for Rwanda, but all of the African countries that are part of AGOA. Now, they've prolonged the AGOA for 10 more years. Now we are on the 9th. I don't think AGOA is going to stop because of the new administration. But at the same time, I'm hoping that we'll get to a point where we'll be industrialized enough in those 9 years that we can deal with equal partnerships. That's where we are. Rwanda has been pushing for our Vision 2020, where we are getting closer to become a middle-income country, and we have heavily invested on industrialization to be able to be exporting and importing both on international and regional areas. So I'm hoping that AGOA, it was a transitionary place to participate and have a leverage on the international market, especially the American market. But eventually, even if it stops, I'm hoping that we can, those kind of ties can continue even under different circumstances. So we are hoping that we'll create other type of avenues for easing trade with Africa and Rwanda in general, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is more for my history and intellectual curiosity. Yeah, Brexit, United States presidential election, some argue, is a sign that countries are becoming less global and more insular. I see that your country is very active and supportive of the East African community and the African Union. Do you think that the U.S. election and Brexit is a sign that your country also might become now more insular?
For us, we are not interested in becoming insular because we have a different trajectory in our development. Our countries in Africa, as most of you know, have been pretty much until recently not really in charge of their own destiny when it comes to trade. We were colonized, and for more than 100 years, we didn't do our own diplomacy. We didn't do our own, we didn't explore our own resources. Those were used to develop European countries, unfortunately. And we became almost like a welfare continent, even though we were the ones who were providing for those resources. So now, when they talk about the African Renaissance, that is real. Is that Africa, whether wherever we are now, but we understand, or the new leadership understand, that Africa has to take its own destiny in their own hands. And I'm happy to say that the people of the brand of my own president, who was recently elected to be by the, or the AU, African Union, or the president together, they elected him to be the chair to bring reforms to the African Union, to see how we can be a little bit self-independent and to become more of partners than recipients of aid, because that's so for us, we are still out there. So for us, opening is a reality, and it's an imperative instead of closing. So the East African community and other type of regional connections are very important for African development, because what has been missing for Africa for a long time has been the intra-African trade. You know, because the movement was always like this, almost one-way street, and sometimes whatever comes back without industrialization was like those little bit of pieces and, you know, stuff, costing 100 times what they... So we have the resources. The resources go some other place, they industrialize, and then what we get are crumbs. And that has been the reality of Africa for a long time. And I think now we are starting to take our own destiny in our own hands. Rwanda is in the forefront. We've opened borders. If you go, for instance, it's the only country that started to open our borders for all the African countries to come without any visa. The East African, one single visa allow people to go to Kenya, Tanzania, and so on, without, and Rwanda, without needing to get any visa. If you go from the United States, you can go to all those countries without having that. But also we've taken our challenges into opportunities. You know, we are a small landlocked country, but we are land-linked more than landlocked. So we are trying to open those kind of borders and also growing in our minds in terms of really linking to the world, you know, and that is something, if you want, I can talk a little bit briefly about. But we ever since there's a responsibility that comes, maybe that was given to us because of hardship, and Rwanda is the fifth nation to provide for peacekeeping and policekeeping throughout the world. And as a matter of fact, next week, if you are interested at USIP, we have the first ever conference on what they call the Kigali Principles that has been signed by 39 nations, including the United States, on how you do protection of civilians. Because in all conflicts in the world, usually you have all this peacekeeping, but people die. So how can you, you know, like in the case of Rwanda, we had the UN. The UN mission was in Rwanda during the time of genocide, but there was no mandate to protect the civilians. So that experience itself has pushed us at least to be in the forefront to see that genocide, mass killings, at least the civilians are protected. So peacekeeping is also about peace building. And what they call Kigali Principles, 18 principles, will be explained at the USIP on December 14th. And we have people from Rwanda, from the Netherlands, from the United States, all the countries that are signatory, who have accepted it within the mandate of UN. And so I think we've gone beyond our borders to see that the lessons, the horrible lessons we've learned, are not wasted to humanity. You know, you've heard about, after the Holocaust, people said never again, Rwanda happened, Bosnia happened, all over the world. But what can you do as a nation? And I think we are a living testament that actually, even after a conflict, people can rebuild, because Rwanda has rebuilt and has done even better beyond in terms of empowering the people, bringing women in, being a country that is doing business, we are the second in Africa and the world. So it means that you really have to have a vision, but also people who are willing to take the challenges into opportunities. So I would say maybe to add a little bit of that.
That's a wonderful answer. Thank you. Thank you so much. Softball question, change a little bit. What's the next step for you after being ambassador to the United States?
I just become a wonderful citizen and enjoy my country. Go and enjoy the, you know, just being in that beautiful nation you want to visit. But I'll go and...
I'm going to go visit. I'll come visit you.
Yeah, please.
Okay. Yeah. How do you, and I think you've done this a little bit, describe to us Rwanda today as compared to 25 years ago?
Aside from the beauty, a place that is attractive to the rest of the world, you know, a couple of months ago we hosted the World Economic Forum in Sub-Saharan Africa. It's amazing. We hosted the African Union. We hosted the technology hub. So all these people are coming to Rwanda because, number one, someone was talking about Muganda. Rwanda was able to develop because of what we call homegrown initiatives, like that idea of cleaning the environment by our own, not paying somebody to do it, but every Saturday, everyone from the president to the people in the villages, they beautify the neighborhood, they build roads, they build the schools, that now we are in a place where we can say, and we own it. That has been also part of our reconciliation process, because when you go and you are digging together, you are building a school together, you are weaving together, this stuff will bring you together without having to talk about the concepts of reconciliation. So those are the stuff that have helped, the socioeconomic initiatives have helped our country to be where we are today. So I can say that's one thing. Our country is beautiful. Our country is developed. The second place to do business in the world. Lack of corruption. But more importantly, a nation. The Rwanda I grew up in was not a nation. I was ostracized because of the ethnic group I came from. I was kicked out of my boarding school when I was 13. Now every single Rwanda finds himself in Rwanda. We have a nation. A nation we are proud of, that would take me from Sacramento, where I enjoy the security and I have my family, and go and work for that country because of the pride I feel for that country. So I would say, I have never, last week, actually 3 days ago, we erected what we call the National Diaspora in the United States. This brings all Rwandans from all the 50 states in the United States. They met in Dallas, Texas. They erected their own administration to say we are interested in being involved in our country development through investments, but also ideas and many different things. You'll find it through your own research. There's no single country where people are coming back like Rwanda. People are going back. The diaspora is coming back. So that shows that people feel a sense of security, peace, but also the excitement that comes with a sense of accomplishment. And that is what I can tell you, without talking about numbers, is what Rwanda is offering right now. So I can
answer.
Say it, yeah.
Thank you. Now, my last question before we turn over to the audience, and I think in some ways you probably have answered it, what would you like to tell this group here today about your country, which we might not know? Is there anything?
Maybe these people can tell you. Let me tell you, my country, it's sometimes, you know, my country is very tiny. It's small. Size-wise, it's like Maryland or Vermont, or, you know, they call it something in the United States. So in essence, you can drive up, down, east, west, and you can finish the whole country in one day. But it has millions of stories. It's one of those countries that is rich in terms of culture. A month ago, we had a big event in San Francisco. we organized a big event. There were about 2,500 people, and we brought all the people to do the culture of Rwanda. That day was for the culture, the dance, traditions, and stuff that they put out there. But they also played the customs, you know, how people get married, how people did this and that. When you go, you can, it's almost like a tale of, what is that book again, a long time ago. But it's a country with many stories, amazing stories, and but loving people, where all the opportunities are there. We just, for people who like bicycling, last week, what is this? There was a big tour of Rwanda, like the one tour of France. Mm-hmm. And all the countries were there, including people from US. So if you like bicycling, and the beauty of the country was part of the whole picture. So, and then the last thing, maybe if you have never been to the country, we are the ones who preserved all those gorillas. It's like a colony of people. You know, when you go and see the gorillas, it's like it's a society. And people go and you can really learn about our ancestors and how they've lived. But they are loving, they get to know you. Every year we have what they call a naming ceremony, and we name the young gorillas. And if you have worked with us, sometimes you are given the opportunity to give a name, and they become your children. So anyway, there are many things to see in the country.
Thank you. Now, I'm sure that others would like to ask the ambassador some questions.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Donna Schaefer, professor of business at Marymount University, and I have my MBA students here with me this evening. And can you please tell us both one advantage and disadvantage of being land-linked, which is a term I really liked, and so mineral-rich?
Thank you so much. That's a good question. Land-linked, sometimes it comes with liabilities because you said there are disadvantages. There was a time, for instance, like a mineral-rich, you know, the eastern part of Rwanda or the western part. That is also part of that corridor with the eastern part of Congo are very rich in minerals. As a matter of fact, if you look at the Republic of Congo, and what has been happening in this country was because of minerals, because many groups have been vying to control the area. So the problem has been, as a matter of fact, and this is something you can find out, especially students when they do the research, is that Rwanda, that whole region is full of minerals. Because, you know, the minerals, they don't follow the Berlin Conference. The Berlin Conference came and divided up Africa, but obviously you don't really separate the countries based upon this stuff. So Rwanda is very rich in minerals. As a matter of fact, we've had many conferences on minerals because it's one of the biggest exports. And also because of our own transparency, we've opened the mines for people to go and see. There are some American prospectors. There are people who are going over there. So it means that the liability has been that, for instance, even in terms of policy, you've heard about what they call the Dodd-Frank Act. You've heard about Dodd-Frank in the United States. That was calling conflict minerals. All the minerals are coming, certain minerals, I think tantalum, whatever. They are about three. But saying that they were coming, maybe people were taking them out of the Congo, and Rwanda was among them. So they were saying that Rwanda was taking those minerals coming there. As it happens now, we have tons of those minerals ourselves, and they are open. So that has been always a liability of those kind of diffuse type of borders, because even ethnically speaking, the ethnohistory of the people over there in the region is similar. It means that people could say a Rwandan was found in DRC, but he's someone who was born in DRC, but he's of Rwandan or ethnically linked to Rwanda. So those are stuff that have been happening, but I think that African nations have been, or at least in our region, we've been able to work on it after, you know, there were quite a few misgivings across borders, where there was a major war between Rwanda and the DRC at one point. But now I think the people are aware of that, and they are paying attention. I can tell you that now we are open 24 hours a day between the DRC and Rwanda because of the that intra-African, intra-regional trade. Yeah, because people were suffering in the region when people crossed the border. So those can come with that, but opportunities. We are now linking with mutual projects, like the Ruzizi project about the power in between DRC and Rwanda. So we are working on that together. We are trying to, there is what they call Central Corridor, where we do a railroad system between Rwanda and Tanzania, going all the way to the ocean, and then the Northern Corridor going through Uganda, and so on and so forth. So we believe you can't really survive on your own. And it's also a multiplier effect, because when you come to do business as an American, you wouldn't like to come and do business with a small country. You want to do business with all the people around, and since most people usually are also, they need the most similar stuff. Even the schools, like Rwanda has opened a school with Carnegie Mellon. It's a graduate school for engineering in Rwanda, but it's open to all the students in the region, and not just the students from Rwanda. We try to open the border and to do that. So the visa, the easing of the visa, now people can come, the especially the tourist visa, you can come to my embassy or go to the Kenyan embassy or go to the Ethiopia, to the Tanzanian embassy, and you can get one. So we are easing that because we believe our destinies are really interlinked, whether we want it or not. Yeah.
I essentially had two questions. One was regarding the upcoming election, and my question looks beyond that. And what I would like to ask you is, are the leadership, or is the leadership of Rwanda training others to become leaders in the future? I understand how the public can be very comfortable with President Kagame, but at some point he's going to have to retire.
Absolutely.
And is there a process by which they're bringing more people into government which the public trusts? And my second question is more global. Mm-hmm. It seems as though the U.S. relationship with China may become more antagonistic over the next few years. And since China is a big investor in sub-Saharan Africa, do you think that will have an impact on relationships between the United States and African countries?
Hmm. Thank you. Okay, on the first question, training the next leaders is what we have been doing all this time. So let me give you a few things. And maybe just to understand the context we are in. Rwanda at independence, that was in 1962, they had one college graduate, one. Then we had the university, that was a small university. Eventually, 1994 happens, every single person died or they left the country. So here goes out of the window whatever leaders you might think of. After 1994, so all this whole vision that I was talking about, Vision 2020, among those, some of the pillars of 2020 is to provide education. The biggest priority in our country is about education. Training leaders, as a matter of fact, like yesterday, and it goes in all sectors. As a matter of fact, for people who have been in our country, you might be surprised to find very young people in government. So if you go to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, you go to the President's office, most of these people, the deputies are very, very young. You know, number one, because demographically, more than 70% of our population are below 30. So it means that really the people we are relying on for tomorrow are young people. And that kind of empowerment has been happening throughout. When Rwanda did the decentralization process in 2000, and giving leadership through villages, it was to inspire also the largest population possible. So it means that even out of rural areas, now we find young people who are going to school, they establish a school, they do, now Rwanda have universal health programs. All this stuff extended to people throughout. So the people are the central piece of it. So that empowerment we are talking about, we also bring leaders. Sometimes when people in the West, I don't like to generalize. When they discuss African people, at least I'm talking about my country because there are places where I would rather see people go as well. But sometimes they forget that even the leaders don't come overnight. They have to betray, they have to come. It's almost like when you say, okay, what is your income? People are just new in what we call the market economy. Right? They are still new in the market economy. If you can say, how come we don't have $2,000 in your bank account? You can't say, how come we don't have too many leaders waiting to go to be a president of a country? You see what I mean? You need to prepare these people. And especially in our case, those leaders don't come every day. And when you are lucky to find one who is doing the best that could ever be, whether it's in our context, but anywhere in Africa, anywhere in the world, because I can establish him among the best leaders. You don't just say, go. And all countries have their own context. When they elected President Roosevelt here 4 times, and eventually they changed the constitution, it's because during that particular time, they felt Roosevelt was the person to go to. So during that particular time in American history, he was the best. He addressed the Great Depression, he did the stuff, that's what Rwanda is doing. For all practical purposes, Rwanda's history is 22 years because we were destroyed to the ground. So that's pretty much when you talk in terms of history, it's almost like yesterday. The generation of the people who are still coming back because the majority had left. We still have people here in the United States who never went back since 94. And their children were born here. These are the people we are trying to engage, to know about the country so they can also participate and contribute to the welfare of that country. So what I'm saying is, so I think I've responded. When that's what we are working on, investing in education, training leadership, all this stuff that we do every single summer, people go from their school. All the kids who are on scholarship for the government, they go back for civic education, so they know about their country. In what they call Ingando, it's another homegrown initiative where they can actually go and learn about the country, the values and stuff like that, so they can take the reins when the time comes. So the training is there. The second thing about China, let me tell you, We don't say we are going to get, partnerships with just one country. That would be a killer, really, for our countries. China, when they come, they do infrastructure in Africa most of the time. And sometimes there are no other countries that are moving in to help with the infrastructure. So you can't say China can't come. Why? Why not? And also, I've been in this country for quite some time. I know that most of the railroad system was built by Chinese in this country, right? So if they come and build my own infrastructure, I'm not going to say, no, China, no. Why? So what I'm saying is China is a partner. We have different ways to connect with China. It doesn't take away our primacy of connection to the United States. So I don't think that there is really any kind of discrepancy when we say we can work with China and at the same time work with the other thing. And when you look at also President Obama went to China and they agree on certain things, they are partners. So what I have found and that is really a little bit of thing to think about, is that sometimes countries like European countries or even United States sometimes say, China, you have to learn how to fish, and China doesn't teach you how to fish. But you know, we are pretty mature that way. We can't give away our country. They come, they give us what we want from them. We give them what they want from them, and they are, you know, we collaborate that way. Same with many other countries as well. But I don't think that we can close the door to China or to any other country, because eventually this administration will say China is no longer there. That wouldn't be, we would be an appendage over here unless you bring all the investments and put them in our country. But I hope I responded. It's not because we stay open, especially in bilateral relationships. Each country, we have certain things we exchange, but it doesn't take away from what we do with this country. And I think this country has been one of the most incredible partner for our country since the days of genocide until today. So I would say there's nothing that will die, and we are hoping that we continue.
Hi, my name is Alicia Jonah. I'm a recent graduate from Florida State University, and I graduated with my MA in International Affairs. And my question has to do with truth and reconciliation and the use of transitional justice in Rwanda. Mm-hmm. Given that Rwanda has used transitional justice, how does the government make sure that women are included both in traditional justice and non-traditional justice settings in seeking reparations and things of that nature?
Thank you so much. What you know, the women are represented everywhere. So when we were talking about inclusion of women, and that women empowerment is central to our politics, they are everywhere. Even on Truth and Reconciliation, we have many women over there, whether it's on village level, whether it's on national level, whether it's, you know, even on all those boards, what they call commissions, they are a part of it. So if it's every single aspect of Rwandan area of life, including even peacekeeping and the police. So someone was, I think maybe you were asking me at one point, how does it really translate into what women do? Because they have changed the whole narrative from anything from family violence, because women now are part, for instance, what they call one stop center, is where when it's someone is there is a family violence, you will go and report to one center, and that center has every single element to help that particular woman, whether it's the investigator, the police, the gynecologist, all these people who need to see the woman or the children. And most of the time we find also those people are women. It means that they take those issues very seriously, but also people feel more comfortable when it comes to. So that has reduced that. So inclusion is big. Inclusion in, you know, what you see is also very helpful, because when you come, you see a woman in a place, and it's about women issues, gender issues. Of course, you are going to be more comfortable than if you see a man sitting when you are talking about rape or any other issues. So that has revolutionized a little bit that. And, you know, there are a little bit of research that was done on those kind of center, and they've proven that that approach has reduced in Africa any what we call family violence or gender-based violence. You know, that is pretty much a global disease, if I might call it. So it's the same even in justice. When, for instance, we had the gachacha, the traditional justice, because we, after genocide, we had quite a few levels of justice. We had the international justice that was just closed recently, ICTR, for big shots. That was in Tanzania. Then we had the Gachacha courts, traditional justice that was implemented in the country, because we felt even the element of reconciliation couldn't come without any prerequisite of justice. So about 2 million cases were seen by Gachacha courts. So all these women also were in the people, what do they call, people of integrity, the people who were part of these courts. These courts, also the women were part of it. Yeah. So what I'm saying, they are piece and parcel of the whole process wherever you go to the country. Yeah. Yeah. And I'm not saying it's perfect. You know, I mean, what I'm saying is that that inclusion is intentional, because we believe if you take the majority of one big majority of the people and you leave them on the side, whether it's in economic empowerment or economic development or any kind of things you can think of, it won't happen, because you are denying yourself of the majority of the population. So we see the women as a big part of that majority we are talking about.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador. My name is Doris Mariani. I'm a former Chief Executive Officer of Nonviolent Peace Force, an organization that protects civilians in war zones. I've had a good fortune to have visited Rwanda. I've seen the cleanest streets in Kigali, the wonderful gorillas, and the sign on the DRC Rwanda border that says, business yes, corruption no.
Yeah.
Literally, got to that sign.
Yeah.
So I was very delighted to hear that your president is now involved at the African Union and trying to work with the African Union. My question is, Rwanda has been an economic success story. How can Rwanda, based on its success, influence or transfer these lessons learned to the rest of the African continent, the 54 countries, of course, many countries? What role do you think Rwanda can play to work with the other African countries based on the incredible success Rwanda has had in its short 20 years?
Thank you so much. That's what Rwanda has done. That's why when the other presidents trusted him to head that group that is going to do reforms, this is our way of really helping. Rwanda has been open, you know, even in conflicts in places of conflict like South Sudan and the Central African Republic. What has been pretty clear is that people come and learn even about our reconciliation process, and we help any way we can, because we've been in that position. And it's something that you take one day at a time, and you have to be invested 100%. But also, all it's multidimensional. It's not like one area. It's not by the state. It's not just the state actors, no. It's the groups, it's the church, it's the elders, it's many different things. So those people coming to learn about how we do it has helped quite tremendously. And as a matter of fact, even now there's a group going to Central African Republic to do those things. So we are willing to exchange with our neighbors, and we learn quite a lot from our neighbors as well, because obviously we can't be, thinking that we do all the stuff better than other people. We learn also from other people. And also we have benefited from the fact that Rwanda is really a very diverse society. Even though we've emphasized on our Rwandanness, but after 1994, people came from all areas of the world. They came from US, they came from Canada, they came from Europe, they came from Africa, and they brought with them also some kind of richness, you know, something where they can contribute in ways of doing things, in terms of, organizations, in terms of businesses, in terms of how they do things. But that idea of being able to bring people together and to really make them see what's important. As I said, as far as I'm concerned, Rwanda became Rwanda, a nation, then, because now we feel part of that kind of experience. Every Rwanda does. So I think that in Africa, it's the same. Our president has been one of the most, the best, you know what they call good neighbor? If you open the thing, he's visiting his country, you know, his fellow Africans. They talk and they are coming to Kigali. We do all those kind of stuff. So in the last couple of months, I think he's visited maybe like five countries. And they talk. They see how they can borrow from each other. And I think that kind of Pan-Africanism, I make it a little bit broader than what we how we define Pan-Africanism, has been driving my president. He really believes that with as Africans we can do a lot. So linking with the North, linking with the Sub-Saharan Africa, we've rejoined some of the organizations that usually, like the Francophone Africa in West Africa and so on and so forth. So I think we are exchanging as we go.
Thank you for joining us for World Affairs Today, a production of the World Affairs Council, Washington, D.C. Stay connected with us at www.worldaffairstoday.org.